I'd like to talk about a new type of our muscle that we've developed, which we call our Sheath-Run artificial muscles. These muscles were first disclosed last year in an article in Science. Now, for you to appreciate these new muscles, I'd like to talk some of the older types of muscles that we've presented in the literature. This is a team effort with a large number of individuals. The key individual in the laboratory is Jukun Mu, who is my postdoc. And you can see here from many collaborators from around the world, from China, Korea, and from Australia, and of course from the United States, where I'm located. Now, our previous types of artificial muscles are what we call our hybrid nanofiber muscles and our polymer muscles. Both of these muscle types provide both tensile and torsional actuation, which will be the case for our Sheath-Run artificial muscle. All of these muscles are powered by a volume change. The power that you see in the back here in the background is one of my two dogs barking. So I must apologize for that, but I can't avoid it. Our hybrid artificial muscles, one type is made by taking carbon nanotube yarns and incorporating a guest into them. We can simply infiltrate this guest into our carbon nanotube yarn, that we later on insert twists into to first twist. And then if we just use twist, we can make torsional artificial muscles. But if we want to make tensile artificial muscles, it's best to insert so much twist that you get coiling. Here's a coiled artificial muscle. Here's applied artificial muscle. These are two types of applied artificial muscle. Another type of artificial muscle that we've invented are polymer muscles made from fishing line and sewing thread. These muscles are especially inexpensive to make because you can just, to make them, all you have to do is insert twists into high-strength polymer fibers that are typically sold as fishing line or sewn thread. Both of these types of artificial muscles provide remarkable performance, typically about 100 times higher performance than natural skeletal muscles. They operate they have very long cycle life. They can be operated in both torsion and tension. Now, our hybrid carbon nanotube artificial muscles are multifunctional in the sense that they can be powered electrically by light or chemically. And what they're powered by is determined by what guest we incorporate into the artificial muscle. Here we show yarns being spun from carbon nanotube forests. A forest of nanotubes is just an array of nanotubes which is perpendicular to a substrate, like the trees of a bamboo forest. We draw from the side of this forest to make a sheet. And we insert guests on top of this sheet, either before sheet, we can optionally do it during the spinning process or later on after we've formed the twisted or coiled yarn. I can see that my movies aren't going to play for reasons I don't understand. This is supposed to be a movie that will play, but unfortunately it's not playing. So how do our carbon nanotube hybrid muscles work? Think of a children's finger cuff toy. This toy has an array of fibers, which is some in a helical arrangement, like the carbon nanotubes are for our twisted carbon nanotube yarn. Now, if a child puts its finger in the ends of this finger cuff toy and tries to pull the fingers out, they're trapped. And that is because the volume of the finger cuff toy is becomes when it when it expands, it actually contracts in length. When the child tries to pull the muscle, the fingers from the toy, it expands the muscle and correspondingly causes it to decrease volume, so the finger is trapped. Here we show, actually the movies, actually videos are working. Here we show a polymer artificial muscle being made, fabricated by just twist insertion into a sewing thread made out of nylon. You can see this is, it's been coiled up, it's twisted up to this state, and then adding additional twist causes it to coil. We can make these muscles so that they either expand during actuation or contract. We do this by playing with handedness, chirality. If we just insert a twist into a polymer fiber, then we obtain a fiber which is what we call homochiral, because the twist within the fiber is the same handedness as the twist of coiling. Now, when you heat the, in this case for the nylon six fiber, when you heat this polymer fiber up, what you do is you cause the polymer to increase volume. That causes untwist of the fiber. That untwist is converted to the twist of coiling, and it causes the muscle to contract. On the other hand, if you coiled the twisted muscle around the mandrel and coiled it in the opposite direction that you inserted twist, then when you heat the muscle up, instead of contracting like here, you get an expansion. Now this twist coiling conversion could be understood by just thinking of an ordinary coiled metal wire. If you stretch a metal wire, it can elongate by several hundred percent. It's not elongating because the metal within the wire is elongating. It's elongating because twist of the coiling is being converted to the twist within the fiber, and that's along the elongation. Now, what are the problems with these remarkable hybrid artificial muscles and polymer artificial muscles? Well, if you insert twist into a fiber, you have very high twist in the five yarn center, but the twist that decreases, I'm sorry, zero, very low twist in the polymer center, but as you go out to the extremities of the yarn, then you have higher twist. So it means since these muscles are twist driven, it means you're only using part of the muscle volume for actuation. So we're, to avoid this problem, we're using what we call sheath-run artificial muscles. So these muscles are driven by a sheath. The twist can be greatest, and the location at high radius, the twist can be greatest. Another advantage of these muscles is that the Sheath-Run muscle is that the rate of chemically driven actuation or thermally driven actuation depends upon the access of that particular part, the actuating part of the muscle, by the either temperature or chemical. And if we can, this access is much easier if we're driving the muscle using a volume change of a sheath rather than the entire muscle. Of course, another problem with our carbon nanotube hybrid yarn muscles is the carbon nanotube yarns are very presently very expensive. So how do these different types of muscles? Again, I told you a little bit about how we made the hybrid yarn artificial muscles. In other words, the simplest case we use is just to take a twisted yarn and infiltrate a guest, melt a guest, or use a solvent to incorporate a guest within the yarn. To make a sheath-run artificial muscle, we instead make the twisted fiber muscle, which could be just from an ordinary yarn or can be from a carbon nanotube yarn, and we put by solution deposition typically a sheath on the surface of the muscle. Here we show that the sheath material doesn't actually incorporate into the yarn, but it stays as a separate layer on the boundary on the surface of the yarn. Now, unless the sheath is sufficiently thick, the sheath will crack because we've inserted a lot of twist in the core of the yarn, and that twist generates a lot of torque for untwist. And the sheath is the only thing that's in the way of that untwist. So if the sheath is too thin, then, or the bias angle, the amount of twist that we've inserted within the yarn is too high, then we crack the sheath, which is destroys muscle performance. And here, on the other hand, we see that the sheath has to be the sheath thickness versus the core diameter has to be sufficiently large to get maximized torsional actuation for a torsional muscle. Here we show cases where we've intentionally broken the sheath by untwisting the muscle in liquid nitrogen. Again, you can see that the sheath is distinct structurally from the yarn in the center. So the sheath does not diffuse into the central yarn. Here again, if the, here we see torsional stroke versus sheath to core ratio. Unless the sheath is large enough, you get no torsional actuation. If it's too large, the sheath doesn't allow the rotation of the yarn in the center. Now, here we compare the behavior of different types of artificial muscles with the Sheath-Run and Hi-Ram hybrid yarn artificial muscles. Again, this is Sheath-Run, and this is run by guests that's distributing with the, in the whole volume. And here's just a actuation of a carbon nanotube yarn, which has no guest. Now, this PEO SO3 is a blend of polyethylene oxide and a sulfonated copolymer, which is a guest on carbon nanotube yarn. And here you can see from a viewpoint of torsional speed, the great superior performance of the SRAM compared to the high RAM. Here you see it in terms of torsional stroke. Again, much higher performance for the SRAM than the high RAM. Both the SRAM and the high RAM have very high cycle life, which is not true for the very small stroke that you get for the carbon nanotube yarn that doesn't have a guess. We can use very cheap core yarns. Here we're using a silk core yarn, and we're using the polymer that's for the sheath, the same polymer as described before. In other words, a blend of a sulfonated polymer and polyethylene oxide. Now, again, here we show the muscle being driven in tensile actuation. Here we're using a coiled muscle, and we make this muscle again by inserting so much twist that we get coiling. Again, we see the superior performance of the SRAM compared to the high RAM. The SRAM is providing about 15% muscle stroke, which is comparable to that of natural muscle. This in the top, we're powering this just by absorbing water from the air and deabsorbing it by pumping on the muscle in order to cause actuation and then to cause reverse actuation, in other words, expansion. Here we're just passing electricity through the carbon nanotube yarn that's at the core in order to get actuation for a SRAM or for a high RAM or for a neat artificial muscle, carbon nanotube artificial muscle. Cycle life is wonderfully long. Here we show just 1,000 cycles for a SRAM, a high RAM, or a neat yarn. The SRAM and high RAM provide over 30,000 cycles. Now, the SRAM provides a major advantage in actuation because the gas, which is driving actuation, from the outside. So if we're absorbing a chemical or water to increase the volume of the gas, it can occur very fast as compared to the case in which the water would use into the full yarn. Here we're showing actuation as we're increasing the frequency, the separation between the strokes is decreasing as we go to higher and higher frequency. And you still see that we get significant stroke when we go to cycle, which are a very small fraction of a second up here. On the other hand, you degrade performance for the high RAM at much lower frequencies of actuation. Here we show the operation of one of our SRAM artificial muscles. This SRAM is lifting 27,000 times its own weight, 12 times a second, while contracting by 5%. This is generating a average full cycle contractive power output of about 9 kilowatts per kilogram, which is vastly higher than the 0.05 kilowatt per kilogram of skeletal muscle. This power that's being generated by the SRAM is about 13 times higher than can be generated by a supercharged V8 diesel engine when normalized to the weight of this engine. We can also make electrochemical muscles based using our SRAM technology. In doing this, what we do is we take carbon nanotube sheet, form it into a cylinder, and then we put inside the cylinder another yarn, let's say a nylon 6 yarn in the middle. And then we insert twist in this carbon nanotube cylinder, and eventually we're twisting in opposite direction on the top and bottom. So we're forming a yarn in the middle, and eventually this yarn gets close enough to the nylon that's in the center that it grabs onto the nylon fiber and inserts twist into this. So you end up finally with a coiled muscle, which has in the center nylon 6 and a sheath of carbon nanotubes. Now we can use this sheath of carbon nanotubes to actuating electrode. We need, of course, a counter electrode, which is could be in the same muscle configuration or located adjacent to the coiled muscle in an electrolyte. And when we inject charge into the electrode assembly, what we're doing is we're causing ions to form in the double layer within the carbon nanotube sheath. And that's causing the sheath to expand, which is causing the actuation of the electrochemical muscle. Now, the electrochemical muscles are far superior when they're from the SRAM type to electrochemical muscles that are hybrid yarn type. We see the tensile stroke of a high RAM compared to a SRAM here. And again, the other performance metrics are provided on the other slides. And again, work capacity, energy conversion efficiency, any metric, the Sheath-Run artificial muscle provides superior performance to the high RAM. Now, this shows the actuation of electrochemically powered SRAM, generating nine times the power, 40 times the power of during muscle contraction of a human muscle. We can incorporate our SRAM artificial muscles in textiles to make intelligent textiles that respond to sweat to open their porosity. This is shown here. This is the textile made from a Sheath-Run artificial muscle. When it's absorbing, when the muscle, the textile has absorbed water, of course, you want it to become porous so that it can eliminate this water to the atmosphere. And this is what's shown here. The porosity, when it absorbs water, the porosity is increasing. We can also operate these coiled carbon nanotube yarn to harvest mechanical energy as electrical energy. We call these devices our Twist-Run energy harvesters. And these Twist-Run harvesters can generate over a wide frequency range, higher peak power, prior art harvesting technology per muscle weight, higher peak power per muscle weight, and higher average power per muscle weight than any technologies, including those that have been known for many, several centuries. Now we can drive. Initially, we drove our Twistron harvesters. We used our artificial muscles, the actuation of them, to drive an ordinary electromagnetic mechanical energy to electrical generator. And the problem there is the muscle is so small, and the converter of mechanical energy to electrical energy is so large that energy conversion efficiency for the whole energy conversion watts per kilogram for the whole system was low. But what we can do is we can take our artificial muscles of the type and use them to drive carbon nanotube yarns that are used as energy harvesters. I'd like to thank you very much for your attention.